Welcome to the Song Revolution.
Inspiring you to dive deeper into your songwriting and creativity.
To reach the world with the message of Jesus.
Here's your host, John Chisum.
Hey, y'all, welcome to the show again. It's been a minute, but I'm so excited about this episode because I got to interview one of my rock heroes, someone who's on top of his game and just the real deal, Bear Rinehart of Need to Breathe. If you know rock and roll at all, you know the band Need to Breathe. Hailing from Possum Kingdom, South Carolina, this trio of hard rocking musicians have been at it for 2 decades and counting, and they've just straddled Christian and mainstream charts with their own blend of gospel, roots, and pop. And I got to sit down for an hour recently with the band's founder and frontman, Bear Rinehart, not long after the birth of his third child, to talk about the backstories behind their new album, Out of Body, It's So Good, and the new normal that they're in with the departure of Bear's brother, Bo, from the group. Say that 4 times really fast. Bear's brother Bo from the group. Need to Breathe has won 16 GMA Dove Awards. They've been nominated for Grammys, and they are a platinum certified band with over 1 million albums sold. That's a lot of records, you guys. And these guys have a solid fan base, and they've toured with the likes of Tim McGraw and Faith Hill and Taylor Swift. Their 2013 rockumentary called Prove the Poets Wrong. It's just a must-see. I love this movie. If you're already a fan or you just want to find out more about them, and we actually talk in this episode about whether or not there's a new rockumentary on the way. Well, Bear and I talked a lot about songwriting, demos, and production, as well as some more intimate subjects like his battle for mental health and how the band has had to come to terms with conflict after he and Brother Bo came to a literal brawl after a show a few years back. Bear was very transparent, and I just love this band even more after getting to know him just a little in this interview today. Well, our show is sponsored by Nashville Christian Songwriters, and we're a coaching and resource company dedicated to empowering Christian songwriters worldwide. Along with 150 episodes of The Song Revolution that you're listening to today, you can read more about how we come alongside songwriters all over the world to help you get better at lyrics and music and ultimately fulfill your calling to promote the gospel through great songwriting. Check us out over at NashvilleChristianSongwriters.com. And don't miss our new course, Your Best Songs Now. It's a self-paced songwriting course that will give you some great insights into how to write even better with a proven process that the pros use to crank out hit after hit. That's all over there waiting for you. NashvilleChristianSongwriters.com. Well, I think you're going to love this interview. Bear was open about his personal struggles and the potholes the band has hit from time to time. He's very authentic and genuine, and anyone who loves Need to Breathe will love this show. So hey, please share this one out to your socials and share the love here on The Song Revolution as we bring you a great new friend, Need to Breathe's Bear Rinehart. Well, Bear, welcome to the show. It's good to
Thanks
have you
for having
on.
Me. Yeah.
Yeah. So I understand some congratulations are in order.
Yes, if that's what you want to call it. We've we had our third boy 3 months ago. So kind of nuts. They're all 5 years old and younger. So it's been wild around here, but awesome.
Yeah. And that's a bright spot in the middle of an otherwise frightening and crazy year. How are you guys holding it together?
It's been good, you know, ups and downs. I think creatively it's been great. You know, a lot of time for me to kind of figure out some things I should have figured out a long time ago. But I think, you know, it's a weird thing not being on the road, of course.
Yeah.
This is the first time in, I don't know, 15 years or so that I haven't toured for this long. So I'm starting to get the itch a little bit, and
I guess,
it's been sweet. I think I've been there for the births of my children, but not, extended period of time around that. So this has been really, you know, I think I'll look back and feel very blessed that I had the time for sure.
I bet. What are some of the things you think you're figuring out in this time?
A big struggle of mine has always been the, you know, doing demos and all that. We always had a guy in our band who did that, and I just never felt confident doing it. So I would make a lot of excuses why not to sort of force myself into doing it this time around. And I got where I really enjoyed it, you know? So that's been good. I've learned a lot about what times I work the best. You know, every write in town starts at 11 and the band, you know, it's working super late hours all the time. But I feel like I've learned, and that like 6:30 to 7:30 kind of that morning time is my best, most clear headed time.
Really?
Yeah. It's been, I feel like most of the song ideas I've had, in the last few months have come during that time, which has been awesome. And then just, you know, just kind of allowing myself to finish songs or forcing myself to finish songs instead of, you know, wait, well, I'll write this maybe someday with somebody else or whatever, you know? Right. So that's been really empowering in a lot of ways. Cause I feel like you look back and you're like, whoa, I've got a lot of material here. It doesn't just feel like a bunch of voice memos or random ideas.
Yeah. So you're actually pushing through to finish songs and to create demos. What are you using to do your demos?
Just more
guitar. Yeah. Okay. So guitar, yeah, vocals.
Yeah. I do piano too. I'm not very good at it, but play enough piano to put on a record. And then I use a lot of that like arcade stuff or, you know, splice stuff for drums and whatever. I kind of piece it together. But you know, a lot of acoustic instruments, our band is kind of built on, you know, all these open tunings or mandolas or baritones and stuff like that, banjos. So I think having those around has been really great for me. It's kind of like, well, I've got the song idea, whatever, but I'm going to start with one of those things and jump off from there.
Mm. Awesome. Well, you guys have a lot of coverage for the new record, Out of Body. And every question I came up with for this interview had already been answered in one place or the other. So, dude, what's the one thing you wish the world knew about you, but nobody's asking?
Oh man. That's a good question. I think this period for me, before all this even went down, the COVID thing, was just, I've struggled with mental health for a while. And I think I've sort of, by staying busy, have just decided that, or not decided, but I kind of avoided dealing with it. And being home has kind of really forced that. But even the year before this COVID thing hit, I was really getting sort of deep into that and trying to figure out, you know, it's like, I feel like I would liken it to an artist who doesn't know his process. You know, it was kind of like that, like, you know, I know that it's in there, but how do I really get it out? What's the efficient way? So Out of Body really is, you know, a year sort of period of counseling for me in a way. I feel like that record, you know, you can pretty much draw comparisons, maybe not direct. I don't name names, but I mean, you can draw a lot of comparisons to that struggle. And I think, you know, there's songs on there, this Child Again, and those songs are really actually where my head is at, you know? And so I think, you know, I think records are, even when you're doing interviews, it gets into this sort of grandiose sort of, you know, like you're saying, a soundbite or a, you know, it's got to be this meaningful thing. But really, for me, it's kind of like swimming through the soup a little bit. And I feel like that's kind of what the record feels like when I listen to it.
Yeah. So some self-disclosure, at least in some kind of general ways, right?
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, about anxiety, depression in your acoustic back in June, when you guys were kind of previewing the record, you had mentioned that. That was actually one of my questions for today, was how much you felt like that influenced your writing in general, but maybe some specific songs like Child Again and even Who Am I, you know, which is the big single. You know, the soundbite quote is really cool from you, you know, which is probably the biggest and most constant struggle I have in my life is being able to accept love. But you grew up in church and your dad was a pastor and you had all that going for you, man. What,
right.
Why do you feel like you struggle with that?
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. I think I'm careful not to bring my sort of struggle with all of that church and the upbringing to other people, because I've realized over time that not everybody had that experience. You know, even my wife, who's had this like great, you know, youth group experience and all that, mine was not like that. You know, it was, I was I wasn't raised for this, but it just I think the effect was I lost some trust in the church and the people that run it and all those things. That doesn't mean I was like ready to throw it all out. But I did have a, you know, when I walk in the doors of the church, it probably is a pretty cynical sort of feeling I have most of the time, unfortunately. And that was because I was behind the curtain growing up, you know, as a pastor in small town. I say this, you know, a lot, that I feel like in small towns, pastors become like the shrink, but they're not qualified to do that. You know, right, it's like every family comes to talk to them. And, you know, whether my parents knew how much I was listening or not, that's kind of my personality. And I was really finding out the worst things about everybody, you know, just a really heavy thing that I wasn't prepared to deal with. And it probably was not even balanced. You know, it probably was just the bad stuff. So I feel like that's kind of the muck of what that is. And it's like, how do you regain that innocence when you know that's, you know, in essence, what God wants? And I think that's been a big part of the journey.
So how has the single, Who Am I, been received? And I know everything is just so off this year, but
right.
How do you feel like that's worked for you guys?
You know, it's been good. I think I really do judge the success of a song by the type of responses you get to it, not how many or, you know, I think, and that's been pretty accurate. Most of the time it correlates with the success of the song. It's in terms of the way people talk about it. I always say that, like, the honor is if people live their life to your music, whatever that is. It could be, you know, it could be inspiring them, or it could be making them feel better for a period of time. It could be work. It could be, you know, whatever. I think that's what Who Am I has been. It struck a chord, it seems like, with people who feel that same way, you know, who struggle kind of, you know, walking into a room, not feeling great about it, not feeling like they belong there. You know, and that's unfortunately very, you know, I think common.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I listened to the record. I was listening to the pre-release, you know, the first few singles that were being released before the whole record came out. And the more I listened, that's the one that I was gravitating to even before I knew it was the Christian single.
Right. Sure.
You know, it just like that just kept resonating with me, and the one that I kept coming back to. And, you know, you grow your roses on my barren soul. It's like, shut up. Dang, man, that's the nice line. So now I know you wrote that with a couple of hit Nashville writers, Jordan Reynolds and Thomas Rhett. So, you know, I'm not going to ask you whose line that was, but I love that line.
Thank you.
How was that process for you guys? And was it an easy thing or?
Yeah, you know, it was my wife was asking me about it the other day because she saw Thomas on like a CMAs or something. I was like, how was that in there? And I was like, honestly, you know, I didn't know him. So, you know, there's a little bit of that going on, as you know. And then, it didn't feel great leaving there. It was one of those days where it's like, you know, you leave and everybody got along, and it was just kind of like, we don't know each other really well, and everybody's process is a little bit different. You know, I find that country music is obviously, clarity is so important with it. And with my music, I'm like, I'm kind of pushing that away a little bit. Mm. So I think that was a little bit of a struggle at first. It's like, what are even our lingo and everything, you know? And what's interesting to me is that we didn't do a lot of co-writes for this record. Really, it looks like it on the liner notes, but the truth is, like, we had a couple guys out on the road with us that we wrote some songs with. It wasn't until the last week we went in and made half the record, and then went in for a week and co-wrote, and we got 3 songs out of the 5 days we co-wrote those days, you know, wow, that made the album. So it felt like a whirlwind a little bit. It felt like some songs, right, we had lying around, we brought in and went like, okay, let's shape them up. And it was really a successful process, you know, for me. But it was one of those days where you just walk out and you're like, I don't know if we got something or not. I sent it to the other guys. I was like, I don't know. Of course, it ends up being the thing. You know, it took a couple of days for me to realize it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think songs can kind of, you know, settle in or congeal, whatever they do. So, who are the other writers that you co-wrote with some of the other songs?
A guy named Trent Dabbs in town, Casey Cooley, who co-produced the record.
Producer. Yeah.
Jeremy Letito is also a co-producer on the record. Emily Weisband wrote Child Again with me. She's like I think she's a crazy talented young, you know, thing. I think think that's mostly, I might be missing somebody, but okay. it was a natural thing. And it like, for some reason, it's just got the right people on the right, at the right time with the right song.
Yeah.
It felt really natural to me. I found that I've only lived in Nashville for 3 years, and I used to have this idea of it, where it sounded like all the records sound the same to me. I was kind of like, I don't want to be any part of that. Our band kind of wore that a little bit on our sleeve about, like, well, we're not going to be one of those bands, you know? But I've found it to be incredibly soulful, and, you know, writers that even if they have big hits and, you know, whatever, big name, they are incredibly, caring about what it is the artist is trying to say. That's been a, you know, an awesome, discovery.
Right. Yeah. I was going to ask you how it was working with Kaysen and Jeremy, and if you felt like there was a lot of you in the production, or, you know, if it was more shaped by them or just more equal team. How did that go down for you?
It was the most team that we've ever done. I think I've definitely used producers before, but like you said, most of the time it's like the producer's taking the lead, or you are. This was, we had all these meetings, dream meetings. Like, you know, we go, you know, have a drink somewhere and talk about what the record is going to be. Mm-hmm. And we really, I feel like, narrowed down what it is we were trying to make, you know, as before we ever got into the studio. So then, you know, Jeremy always describes it as buoys. He's like, well, let's just imagine you had four buoys in the water and they had to be relatively close to you. You know, like, we're not trying to cling on to them, but like, they're close.
Right.
And I think that was what we did. You know, we talked about sort of anthemic rock and what the drum sounds would be. And that was kind of like in a thing. And then it's like, okay, the acoustic needs to be this way. So yeah, I think it was a really inspiring thing for me, because it felt like they were in the band, you know, which I think was important for us. My brother left the band. So this is the first record we had made, you know, without him in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
So it was important for us to feel safe, and like, you know, they weren't going to run away with this thing without bringing us with them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I was going to ask you about that. What remnant of Bo is on the record? Did he do any co-writing at all early on that wound up on the record?
And yeah, I definitely did. A couple of the songs more than others. We tried to pick songs as we went into it. We tried to pick songs that weren't, we kind of always used to joke that we split everything, but he definitely has his and I have mine, in the sense of who brought the idea to the table. So we tried to avoid that on this record, to be honest. So anything he had written that kind of he brought to the band that was close to him, we tried to avoid. So most of the stuff were like more kind of traditional co-writes, or songs that have just been around for a long time, and they just get shaped, you know, in sound checks or whatever, and it becomes that thing. So, you know, obviously less than most times. I think he's a huge part in the previous records of sort of the landscape of what the thing is going to look like.
Yeah. Is he doing all right? What's life like for him? I know all your fans really like probably want to know, you know, after what, 2 decades, and now he's out and doing his thing. So,
yeah, I think he's okay from what I hear. We don't keep up as much as we did, for sure. And, so I hope that he is. I think the band is really, hopeful that, I mean, the time off from this, you know, kind of inspires. And I think I found that to be true. I did the solo record. It really gave me a love for this again, you know? So I hope he has that similar sort of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, all the best to Bo for sure. 16 Dove Awards, platinum certified band, Grammy noms. Where do you feel like you're going in this after what, 2 decades already? And you know, are you hitting the goals you envisioned? Do you feel like you're breaking through in a bigger way, or, you know, career-wise, man, where do you feel like you guys are?
Yeah, I think that we never were as ambitious as, you know, as maybe most bands. We always wanted to play the club, you know, sell out the club in our town. And then it was like the Ryman, and then it became Red Rocks. And now it's like, there's not a lot really. I mean, people would say the Garden would be our next step, but it's not close to my heart in the way that, you know, the Ryman was, for instance. You know, I'm not from New York, and I haven't seen maybe any shows in that venue before, you know?
Right.
So I think in terms of where we are, we feel really empowered, because one of the goals was always self-sufficiency. This idea, like, we want to make a record, we can just go in and make the record we want to make. You know, we have a label partner right now that pretty much lets us do what we want. If we can dream it, they'll pay for it. So that's kind of what we wanted, you know, and the touring thing is all self, you know, contained and sustained. When we want to go to the road, we can, you know, and that was an ultimate goal, I think, for us too. When we first started out, it was like, we never want to be, you know, the kind of band that's taking tour support and all these things and having to, you know, the label say, well, you can't go on tour this fall, whatever it is. So I think that creative control, and even when we are ambitious now, I think we're real careful. I mean, we're guilty of it like anybody, but we're real careful to say what I like about getting bigger. I think we had an arena tour on this fall we were going to do. We played Bridgestone for the first time and all that. And what's exciting about that is the possibilities of the creative stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I've always been, man, you know, you play the club thing, you do it, you just get as good as you can at it. And then it's like, oh, the next step is, man, it'd be awesome if I could have my own staging and the piano could come out of the ground. You know, just make
hydraulics.
You
know what
I mean? It's just all this stuff that I've always wanted to try that. And I think if we could have those tools, you know, that would be really cool for the fans. And so anyway, I think that's the next step for us, is kind of stepping into that. And who knows when that'll be at this point.
For real. Well, what I bet you tasted some of that. Of course, I didn't see the tours with Taylor and with McGraw and Faith Hill, but what was the production value on those? Did you feel
a massive, we were playing stadiums, and when we played in Dallas and stadium and all that, we played a couple nights at the Garden, and it was insane. And for us at the time, that was the first stuff we had done like that. The Taylor Swift stuff. So it was a huge learning curve. And it's not because, you know, you just think, well, the band's good, that ought to be good in that scenario. And I think that's true if you're like Chris Stapleton. It's like you can take the club show into the arena and everybody's cool with it. But when you're competing with Taylor Swift, it's like, it's like, man, you really got to learn how to work the camera. And, you know, most people are looking at your face on the camera rather than your whole body or the way the band interacts. And
So that must have been quite an experience, you know, to be there with Taylor, such a megastar, iconic. And, you know, really loved your 2013 Prove the Poets Wrong video. And are you guys going to do anything else? Another rockumentary or anything like that?
We kind of are. We might or might not have filmed that already.
I can neither confirm nor deny.
Exactly. But some stuff's coming up with that. It's going to be different than that, but I think more of a catch up of where the band is now. And it feels, I'm really excited about it. It just feels really good. And a lot more new music. And I mean, the truth is we just work. I mean, we like to work and we like to get together. Mm-hmm. And we're in a really, especially right now, the band's just such a sweet place. It's, you know, we decided we couldn't tour in the fall, or we didn't decide, but we were told we couldn't tour in the fall. It's like, oh, let's go do some stuff, you know? So we've some interesting things coming out we haven't done before.
What do you feel like you've learned between Hard Love and this record, and realizing this record is probably starting to feel like you haven't toured it yet, but you're so used to these songs by now, but what do you feel might be different other than Bo stepping out, you know, anything different? Feel like you've learned
something? Yeah. I mean, I think I've learned a lot. I mean, you learn sort of in the reverse way. Sometimes I feel like with Hard Love, I think that was a poppier record. The band, truthfully, was not in a great place while we were making the record. I think that comes across, you know, saying that I was also proven wrong. That record is going to be a gold record. So it's like, what do I know? You know? So I think there's a level of that, sometimes to see, you know, when the band gets bigger, it's really hard to think about the audience, like broken up in different ways, but you know, I think about that more now. I feel like Hard Love taught us that. It's like in an amphitheater, if you're at Red Rocks and there's 10,000 people, you know, if you break it down, it's like 1,000 people there really know everything about your band, you know?
Right.
And 6,000 know, they know mostly. Yeah. And then like the back 5,000, if one person left, they wouldn't even know. They just like two songs and they saw us at Tim McGraw or whatever, you know? I think when you're a young band, it is true. And it feels like everyone is intensely into every move you make. Whereas the band gets bigger. So I think that was something. I feel like Hard Love sort of created some of that success that was outside of that inner circle, and probably a good thing.
How does Josh make his hair do that thing?
Weird is he does nothing to it. Yeah. He literally, I mean, his wife is a hairstylist. So she can cut it occasionally, but that's literally, that's the way he wakes up. Isn't that insane?
It's kind of like a it's kind of like I imagine dreadlocks, only it's like a big poofy pile of.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
It is cool. We nearly didn't bring him into the band because of that. He before he had it styled the way he does now, it was kind of like a fro and it sort of flopped around when he played piano.
Yeah.
And we saw a video and we were just like, this guy's not for us. Anybody that would use that, you know.
Yeah.
And we
found
out later that he actually the band that he was in made him wear it like that. So got a pass.
It's kind of an amoeba like. It just kind of shapes different shapes, different pictures. And some amoebas there. It's, it's like every picture is a different shape. That's kind of cool. Tell us a little more about Randall and how can I get one of his t-shirts? I mean, is he really a part of the band? And he played banjo and
he did play banjo. I mean, he's a really good musician. He is an anomaly. I mean, I think somebody needs to make a movie just about him. He's, from a small town, North Carolina. We met him at a camp that we went through and played. He was running sound. Next thing you know, he's our guitar tech. He could not tech guitars. He had no idea what he was doing. I remember our old piano player, David Leonard, who's now in All Sons and Daughters, and then he does his own
love
thing now.
David.
He said, Randall, you know what you're doing right there. And I was like, not really. Can you help me? That's the way he was, that guy on the road. And next thing you know, our drummer leaves and just, we tried out 12 guys in Nashville and none of them stuck.
Right.
And, he just kind of has morphed his way into this thing. And he's always surprising me with stuff like that. Like he was a percussion major in college and, you know, so he like, oh, I know how to play the xylophone. I'm like, I've known you for 7 years. I had no idea you could play like that.
Yeah. With double mallets.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, what's happening? Yeah.
Yeah.
So he's just he is a very talented guy, but he's so soft spoken. He's never going to lead with that. And, I think one of the cool things about him too, is that he's the guy who's friends with everybody on the tour. That's behind the scenes. So, you know, Randall probably knows all of our bus drivers that we've ever had, our truck drivers, the guy that he is really great with that. He leaves the venue knowing, you know, the people that work there. And that's inspiring.
Yeah. Randall for president.
There you go.
Well, I know you don't carry the typical label of a Christian band, but the gospel overtones are just so strong, you know, throughout everything you do, song like Survival with Drew and Ellie Holcomb. Do you feel like this holds you back in mainstream music at all? And what are the challenges, if any, of walking that line?
I think it did for a long time, to be honest. I think there was a time, 15 years ago when it was a really, it just, in, especially in pop world, it was just like you could not do it. You know, I think a lot of those doors have been sort of broken down or opened or, I don't feel that at radio anymore. We still feel, I'll be under a venue somewhere, in the hallways and I hear the crew guys talking and they'll be like, who's playing tonight? I don't know. Some Christian band. So clearly, if you're a rock guy like that, that's just like, well, that's a turnoff. I haven't even heard them yet. So I do think that, but saying that, I feel like it's also why people relate to our music. You know, I feel like I interpret life via the sort of God story, And so I think that's why it's all, even though we're not writing, trying to write Christian singles or whatever it is, they kind of turn out that way. And I just think, I think us not doing that would just be completely not who we are. So I don't think it's worth, I think I've talked to John Foreman about this. It's like, it's just not worth now second guessing that. It's, we would have nothing without that.
Mm. Yeah. Well, it's powerful stuff. All right. Two words. I almost hesitate to even say these words because you've talked about this in so many places, but hey, this is my show. I want you to talk about this. So two words, Possum Kingdom.
Yeah, that's where we grew up, man. It's my dad was a Assembly of God youth director for the state. And they had a campground. They used to send, unlike a Baptist camp or something, they would send all the kids to one place because there's not big churches, So so that's where we grew up. It was insane. It was amazing. We had the place
kind of
ourselves.
Between Atlanta and Charlotte. It's in South Carolina. Yeah. Really close to Mud Bog, I understand.
Right, that's right.
Did you go hang out at the Possum Kingdom Creamery?
I did not. I did not. I was so young. I was until I was 10 years old. But it's, I mean, it's insane. The, you know, the being raised like that was really fun because it was some sort of odd, balance is not the right word, but just like contrast where all winter, no one would be there. You know, we have this whole campground by ourselves, and then the summer starts and there's like 300 kids there every single week. So it felt like we got that culture, social kind of thing almost, you know, reverse for us in the summer and, right. you know, homeschool during the winter. So it was a really cool time. And I think, you know, I look back on that as probably why we thought we could do this. I think you have to be, crazy, as you know, I think to get into songwriting and decide this is what I'm going to do.
Absolutely. You know?
And I think we just had that because we didn't know much better, you know?
Right. But your dad was real musical and pulled a lot of music into the camps. And
yeah,
was he bringing bands through and
he was
and that kind of thing?
Yeah. Yeah. He was into, I mean, he was into all kinds of theatrics, so it didn't matter to him. I mean, he was just trying to make the kids have a great time. And back then, this is pre like, you know, lawsuits. So he had like, you know, the water slides that he built and all these like, you know, thing we called it was a zip line over the lake. And, you know, he would do a candy drop, where literally my uncle would fly a small, like Cessna plane over the softball field and drop buckets of candy on the kids.
You're kidding. Buckets. Buckets of candy.
Yeah. So he was into it, but he's also, like you say, super musical. My mom was a piano teacher. So we were around it all the time.
So you picked up a bunch from him just innately, just seeing how to work with crowds and get people involved. And
I think definitely that. And I think the other thing is just excitement, you know, just the feeling, you know. I think it's weird to me always because I hear people like they get into music some way and they didn't have some connector like that where you see people really, I mean, my dad just experienced music on a very, you know, it's like, you got to come listen to this. This is insane. You know, this is unbelievable. And we grew up, like used to be a show called Sessions at West 54th. It was on public radio and they have like, or public TV. And it would be like Keb Moe or Lucinda Williams or all these, you know, like people like that.
Right.
And we're just blown away by it. And my dad, you have to come watch this. And he would tape it on a VCR so we could watch it the next day, you know, all this stuff. So I think there's an excitement to that. Yeah.
What a great dad, man. What a great influence and his legacy in a lot of ways continuing through you guys. So, yeah. So, you know, it seemed like over the years, you know, you and Bo, you know, had some strife, and you can't be so intimately involved in a band like that and not have real life struggles. And, you know, even, some coming to fisticuffs, coming to some fights and stuff. And even, Seth and look, was it Seth and Bo
in the film,
it's like, dang, you know, how do you resolve stuff like that? I couldn't imagine. How do you come back from that?
Honestly, it's hard. I mean, at the time, we just somehow forgot it the next day. It was just, it was very high intensity and the fights were so, I think if people come on the road with us, they would always be like, man, I think these guys are going to break up.
Yeah,
and just the way we lived, you know.
Absolutely.
I think, you know, the lessons we've learned is that conflict, you have to have it. You know, it's just a matter of, can you have healthy conflict? And I think that thing for us has always has been about like empowering people around us. You know, it used to be when two of us got in a fight, everybody bailed. And then whoever was the most insane in that fight won, you know, it's like, or willing to fight the longest or whatever. So people in the room to say, you shouldn't do that. That's against the rules. We're not going to have that. Or maybe we shouldn't have this conversation right after the show. Let's wait till the morning and see how we feel, you know?
Exactly.
So I think that is a big part of it. And about after we had our big sort of blowout fight, we instituted a lot of things, and that had to do with from the ground up, the crew guys and tour managers and all that's kind of like, okay, here's the things we need kind of in place. And we're giving you the power to enforce them, in order for us to kind of keep from just going off the rails.
Yeah. 'Cause it's a business. I mean, it's a franchise. It's a business that you got to run it with some systems in place and things like that. It's all fun and games till somebody gets hurt. Right. off the water slide.
Yeah. So. They don't tell you that when you start a band in your garage. absolutely zero skill in that department. And all of a sudden like, whoa, we got to figure this out.
Well, let's get a plug in for One World Health Center, Tola, Nicaragua. Nicaragua. Mm-hmm. I'll say it right. I'm totally good. I'm messing that up. How's that going? And I think you're opening a second, or you have opened a second.
Yeah,
we have center. Do you guys get down there and tell us about the heart behind that?
Yeah, we do. I went on a trip to Africa with them. Went to Uganda. My wife's a nurse practitioner, so that kind of she's really the one who drug me on the trip the first time. Grew up around mission work and missionaries my whole life. Always had a beef with the idea of sort of relief work rather as opposed to what is the solution of this? How can we help them long term? Is this sustainable? And so I went on plenty of my own, mission trips where I'm doing the puppet show and then leaving. So it was really cool to see an organization that had a long term plan. It basically what they do is they build medical clinics, charge on a sliding scale so that people can afford it. And they, provide a high level of care in places that just don't have it. And then the idea is it makes its own money after a year or 2 years at the most. And so we have two clinics in Nicaragua, which we went, I've been to both of them, for the openings and then been back since, but they, are running on their own. It's kind of a crazy thing. So, and when all this COVID stuff is over, the plan is to do one in Uganda as well. So, and there's a pediatric wing at the hospital in Uganda that they built that the fans paid for. So, it's been fun. It's been a cool thing because we kind of grew with the charity.
Right.
And so we were always like, you're not going to come speak at our shows for 30 minutes. Like that's not happening. So we're not going to take the fan experience away, but how can we be creative with it? So, a dollar a ticket goes to them. We do a golf tournament. We've sold t-shirts or posters or whatever. Just give the fans a chance, some opportunity to give if they want to.
Yeah.
And they've been great with that.
Yeah, that's cool. Well, I want to invite our listeners to go check it out. One World Health Center at NEEDTOBREATHE.com and jump in and help these guys and help the folks, help everyone down there. Well, Bear, thank you so much, man.
Of course.
Coolest band ever. Great new music, and we just wish you all the best. Thanks for spending a little time with us.
Of course. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Yeah, bud.
Thanks for listening to the Song Revolution podcast, designed to help you live a more inspired and meaningful life.
Subscribe now and share this podcast with the creatives in your circle.
You can connect with John Chisum on Facebook or
visit NashvilleChristianSongwriters.com to take your songwriting to the next level.